family members and being friends, and we thank you for coming to share this morning. Today we share in the loss of Melanie Granbery Chambliss. We've come here to weep, and we've come to feel our loss and to wonder in our anguish, to learn what is good and to learn to feel our grief and to find our completeness in God. We do not come here today with any answers in the mystery of life and death, but let's face it, it's tough, and we're stunned and we're shocked and we all hurt. We don't understand why some leave us at young ages or even at older ages. We always want to cling to each other as long as we can. It might be difficult to believe, but the Bible says that it's actually good for us to be here today. In Ecclesiastes 7:2, it says, God says this, it is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. For death is the destiny of every person. The living should take it to heart. In other words, God says today that it is better to go to a funeral than to a party. I think there are at least three reasons for this. The first of which is a time for us to celebrate the life that God gave to Melody. The things that she learned, the things that she accomplished, and the best of things, her legacy, which is her kids. Today we are sad, but we want to also remember Melody's uniqueness. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this time to come and be in a house of mourning, to be here and to share in the memories of our loved ones and our family. And we thank you for Melody, whose life gave us pause. It gave us time to think about what is best in the world. She was such a driven young lady and so many struggles later in life, and we just ask that if it be your will, you would receive her unto yourself today in a way that would be pleasing ever before you. For every person that's here today, we lift their hearts to you that you might mend them, that you might give them peace in their grieving, but that you would allow them a grieving process so that they can understand their own mortality and find their own relationship with you. We ask these things in your Son's precious name. Amen. In a few moments, those that will be speaking towards the eulogies, if you would at this time, just get ready to come up. Melanie Dawn Granbery Chambliss of New Boston, Texas, passed away Monday, June 20th, 2022 in DeKalb, Texas. Melanie was born February 5th, 1981 to Michael Earl Granbery and Janice Marie Williams Granbery. She was a homemaker who enjoyed spending time with her children. She was preceded in death by her maternal grandfather, Kenneth Williams, paternal grandparents, Elmer Bid Olita Granbery, an uncle Steve Granbery, and Aunt Bama Gaunt, a cousin Daniel Granbery, and her husband Jeffrey Scott Chambliss. She is survived by her father, Mike Granbery of DeKalb, her mother, Janice Granbery of New Boston, her two sons, Brandon Chambliss, both of New Boston, and her daughter Zoe Granbery of New Boston. One brother, Caleb Granbery of Dallas, her maternal grandmother, Etta Williams of New Boston, Texas aunts and uncles, Kathy and Eddie Bridge of DeKalb, Flo and Gary Owen of New Boston, and Stephen and Cindy Williams of New Boston, and numerous other relatives and friends. When I spoke with some of you about her, I learned some great qualities about her. I learned that she loved her kids and that she was highly driven by her mom to do well in life and to do well in school. Yet, struggles always seem to find us. And for her struggles, sometimes only God can fix those. And so in this time, it is for us to remember that second is a time for us to say so long to Melanie until we see her again. Life will continue. God still has a plan for our lives to continue in her memory and to do right by him and what is left to be done in his future. This helps us to never forget our relationship with her and does help us to move forward without her here. Third, it is a time for us to take a look at our own lives. We are going to die someday. It is a great time to ask tough questions like, am I ready to die? How is my relationship with God? How is my relationship with those around me? When it comes right down to it, this service is more for us than it is for Melody. Jesus told us to focus on the living, and that we should understand we need to do what we can for those that are left behind. And so we're going to remember, we're going to say until we meet again, and we're going to reflect on what we should do in our own lives. At this time, those who would like to speak that have been asked to speak, if you would come up one at a time. There's a microphone and a stand here if you don't want to come up here.
Letter to Melanie, to my sweet, precious Melanie. Lord, how I miss you. I've been seeing your face. I missed our many conversations, whether they were good, bad, or ugly. We ended each conversation with, I love you. You went through a lot in your short life, and I did my best to help and encourage you to never give up and never stop fighting. I regret that I never told you how much you also encouraged me in so many ways. The list is endless, but I'll only mention a couple. You encouraged me to appreciate life and live it to the fullest, and I always give God the credit and praise that he deserves. And for that, I say thank you, sweetie. Your little body was tired, so God called you home to rest. So rest in paradise, my love, until we meet again. I love you on the brain.
Those of you that don't know me, I'm Jennifer. I was one of Melody's best friends since we were 6 years old. Melody lived a really hard life for as young as she was. And she hurt more than any one person should ever have to. So I take great peace in knowing that she's not hurting anymore. I tried to sit down and write. There's no way you could put our relationship into any words. And so I always drew the same words. She was a blessing to me. She loved unconditionally when she loved you, no matter what you were going through. She was very precious, no matter what she went through in life. She was a very precious person. And I thank God every day that he put her in our lives. And I'm very thankful that she can be with Scotty now. She adored her children. She loved shooting guns at her dad's, fishing. And she loved going to any sports or anything that her children were involved in. And her family is what kept her going. It's the only thing that kept her going. And I'm just grateful and thankful that she's no longer in pain, and she can be with Scotty, and that she can look over all of us. And I'm thankful that she's in our lives.
I did not have the opportunity to know Melody, but I know her kids. I know her relatives. And so for you kids, I want you to listen real close. I didn't have a great relationship with my mother, and I didn't have a great relationship with my father. And I lost both of them, just like you. So even though I didn't know your mom, I get to know you, and I get to help you through the times that you have questions. So anytime you need me, I'm here for you. Okay? We are seeking questions. It is a very human thing to do, to ask questions of every situation, to ask questions of everything that we see, of everything that we go through. It is even more human to not have the answers than it is to have the answers. There's so many things that we ask why. Why me? Why him? Why her? Why did you take them so young? Why did you let them suffer so long? All these different questions. And we always ask God these things because we don't have the human answers, but God has the eternal answers, the spiritual answers, the answers that can fill the void. And even though I lost my parents just like these kids, God always gave me another mom or another dad or another person to fill that void through him and in him. Another Christian brother, another Christian sister to help me get through things. So today you may be here and you may be asking, well, why did Melody have to die so young? Or why did she have to go through so many struggles in her young life? Or all these different things. And there's a story in the Bible that addresses some of the same things that most of us are feeling today. Most of us ask these questions, and it's found in the Gospel of John in the 11th chapter. And here we read of a funeral that involved hard questions, deep feelings, and a budding hope. The deceased man is named Lazarus. He comes from a very close family. Among them are two of his sisters, Mary and Martha. And like Melody, he came from a good family, had a bunch of friends, and had one of the best friends you could possibly have, who was Jesus Christ himself. It reads this way. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This, Mary's, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. When he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Now when he had heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was for two more days. And then he said to his disciples, let us go back to Judea. But Rabbi, they said, a short while ago, the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you're going back. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light. After he had said this, he went on to tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better. Jesus had been speaking about his death, but his disciples thought he meant a natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I am glad I am not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. No one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up and quickly went out to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been there with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn him. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, the Jews who had come along her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. And Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he have opened the eyes of the blind and have kept this man from dying?" Isn't that just like human nature? We want to say, well, it's Jesus' fault because he's not with us. Or, you know, if he had been with me in that moment, that wouldn't have happened. Or if he had been with me here, that wouldn't have happened. Or this wouldn't have happened. We're so quick to blame God or Jesus for the things that happen in our lives. Even those that loved Jesus, that knew him, said, "If you'd only been here, our brother wouldn't have died." You see, Jesus arrived 4 days after Lazarus died. And as he approaches the house full of people crying, both his sisters run out at separate times, "Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died." I suspect some of us are asking, if I had only spent time with her, maybe she would have been around longer. Or if I had only been nicer to her before she died, maybe I'd feel better about myself. Or if I had only done this for her. Or if I'd only done that for her. These are quite normal questions. But the Lord wouldn't have you blame yourself. It's not healthy and it's not right. Things in life are never simple. They're never as good as they should be. We just do not live in a perfect world. It may be hard to think for some Christians, but if we're not supposed to blame ourselves, then maybe we are supposed to blame the Lord. That's exactly what Mary and Martha did. "Lord, if you'd just been here, my brother wouldn't have died." I learned long ago that it is really senseless to either accuse God or to try to defend him. I believe that God wants us to question him in a way that we can learn from him, in a way that he intended for us to have a perfect life with him. You see, he didn't make an imperfect world. We did. We shouldn't feel guilty for wondering if there was something that God could have done But our answer is always found in this scripture, Romans 8:28. All things, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. Zoe and Bibi, remember that scripture. It will give you comfort in the worst of times. Remember that anything bad that happens to you can be turned to good by God for those that love him and are called according to his purpose. So that means any bad that happens to you in life, any bad that comes against you, God can use that for his good in your life. Okay? Jeremiah 29:11 says he has a perfect plan for your life as well. How can death be good? How can struggles be good? God can turn any bad, any wrong, to his good. As we continue with the story of Lazarus, we find the shortest verse in the entire Bible, surrounded by family and friends, Jesus, who is deeply moved for his friend, asking where the body is, when he views Lazarus, knowing that he can wake him up, that he can raise him from the dead, he still weeps. So if you're sad, it's okay to weep. If you're hurt, it's okay to weep. Here's the greatest person of us all, Jesus of Nazareth, the world's most complete, most perfect man, attending the funeral of a friend and openly weeping without embarrassment or apology. In fact, those watching him said, "See how much he loved him." God wants a relationship with us, a relationship that understands loss. You see, Mama, this is for you. God knows your loss. He knows your suffering because he too lost a child and raised him again. God wants a relationship with us that leads to eternity. This happens in our story when Jesus said to Mary and Martha in verses 25, 26, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies." And he asked her, "Do you believe this?" So I ask you, do you believe this? Jesus didn't merely say there is a resurrection. He didn't just claim that he was the resurrection. The fact that he would rise from the dead and guarantee that others would too secures our eternity. We often think that this is the land of the living, and that when we die, we go to the land of the dead. I would turn that around. I would say this is the land of the dying, and we're going to the land of the living. There are really only two possible destinations for us: the resurrection life in heaven, or the eternal life and torment. Jesus says the only requirement is that you personally believe that he exchanged his life for yours. He absorbed your sins on the cross, never to be brought against you again. He offers you faith. He offers you hope. This is real stuff. God wants to be with, in, and in us all times, whether grieving or whether we're in the happiest moments of our lives. James 4:14 says, what is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Young or old, no one plans to die. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but no one's willing to die to get there. Life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then passes away. None of us know when it's going to happen. Our lives are fragile, and God wants us to be a part of them. Proverbs 27:1 reminds us not to boast about tomorrow because we don't know what the day will hold or bring forth. Some people are always bragging about what they're going to do and that they never do anything. One of these days I'm going to do this, or I'll tackle that later. But later never comes. I know some of you wives are probably elbowing your husbands. This passage gives us two very significant reasons why we should never presume upon the future. Life is unpredictable. We don't even know what will happen tonight, much less next week or next year. The truth is that no one can predict the future. Life is brief. Our lives are like a mist that appears for just a short little while and then is gone. The Greek word here is atmos, from which we get the word atmosphere, which is the invisible layer of water vapor that encircles our planet. Our lives are like a mist in the grand scheme of things. Friends, life is too unpredictable and too brief to live without Christ. We count our lives in years, but God tells us in Psalms 90:12 to number our days. The truth of the matter is that all of us are just one heartbeat away from eternity. 1 Samuel 23, David said, yet as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, there is only a step between me and death. Jesus said, whoever believes in me will live even though he dies. Do you believe this? If not, don't waste another minute of the only life you have. Right now, decide to pin all your hopes on Jesus Christ and in him alone, who exchanged his life for yours. And the next life will reach you. We can know today that we have eternity with God. We can have eternity with God through Jesus Christ if we simply accept him, believe him, and commit to him. This will change our life. It will be a change that will sustain you through the worst of times and through the best of times. Today, Melody has come to an introduction of God that we can only imagine. And we are still here. And God is waiting for that same introduction, that same moment when you come before him. But he wants to be in relationship with you now. Don't wait till you get to heaven to improve your ways. Accept God now. The answers we seek can only be found in God, and I pray that we find him. Let us pray. Father God, we love you and we praise you. We thank you for Melody's life, and we thank you for her children. We expect great things out of her children. Great things for you and great things for their lives. Allow us to be a part of raising them in such a way that is pleasing before you. That they would know you in a way that would be an eternity of privilege. In Christ's name. Thank you. receive the benediction. Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their lives lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Almighty God, in your hands, we commend your daughter, Melody Dawn Granbery Chambliss, and sure and certain hope for resurrection of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This body we commit to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labors, for their deeds will follow them." May God bless and keep you this day. May you offer comfort to the family. And may God put a hedge of protection around you that walks with you through eternal life. In Christ's name.